Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Backpacking with the Saints, Wilderness Hiking as Spiritual Practice by Belden C. Lane. Narrated by Jim Denison. I don't think it is enough appreciated how much an outdoor book the Bible is. It is a hypaethral book, such as Thoreau talked about, a book open to the sky. It is best read and understood outdoors, and the farther outdoors, the better. Wendell Berry, Christianity and the Survival of Creation. Solvitur ambulando. It is solved by walking. Medieval saying attributed to Saint Jerome. Prologue. An intellectual is all the time showing off. Lovers dissolve and become bewildered. Intellectuals try not to drown, while the whole purpose of love is drowning. Jalaluddin Rumi. I go over the checklist of things I carry into wilderness, spread out on the basement floor. Simplicity is what counts here. None of this is high-end gear, more army surplus and camp more than REI. There's a Kelty pack with internal frame, a Whisper light stove, my water filter and matching Nalgene bottle. Next to the old Peak mummy bag, good down to 15 degrees Fahrenheit, are the Maglite, waterproof match case, and a first aid kit from the Wilderness Medicine Institute. The usual stuff. This time I've added the Rhodes Mountain topog map for Wolf Hollow, and a dog-eared copy of Cassian's Conferences from the Classics of Western Spirituality series. Deciding what to carry and what to leave behind is always the first step. That's why I'm ambivalent about a book with a title like Backpacking with the Saints. You don't plunge into wilderness with a how-to-do-it book in tow. You can't squeeze spiritual insight into your sack along with a Swiss Army knife. The wilderness doesn't open itself to books, nor do the saints offer easy answers. So I'm wary of hauling a library along on a backcountry trip, even one of the spiritual classics. Will Rogers, the wry humorist from the Oklahoma Hill Country, had little confidence in the power of books to teach what the land usually teaches better. There are three kinds of men, he remarked. The one that learns by reading, the few who learn by observation, the rest of them have to pee on the electric fence for themselves. Some of us, men and women alike, have to learn the hard way, even though we carry a book along with us out of habit. Women who write of their experience in wilderness say the same thing. Cheryl Strayed, in her recent book, Wild, recounts the mistake she made on a 3-month trip hiking the Pacific Crest Trail alone. Anne LaBastille, wildlife ecologist and author of the Woodswoman series, writes of lessons she learned living for years in the Adirondack Mountains of upstate New York. Gretel Ehrlich, struck by lightning while hiking in a thunderstorm on her Wyoming ranch, found healing in trekking the Greenland ice cap. Among the risks that Roshi Joan Halifax has taken in her life is a circumambulation, Parikrama, of Mount Kailas in Tibet. There she reached the top of the Dolma Pass at 18,600 feet, leaving the ashes of Tenzing Norgay, the first person to climb Mount Everest. In 1955, Ebba Gatewood was the first woman to hike the 2,168-mile Appalachian Trail, solo, at the age of 67. Initially thinking the trip would be a nice lark, she drolly replied, "It wasn't." Like many of these women, my chief reason for hiking is to walk off an inordinate attachment to words. I'm there to let the mind empty itself, usually after a long period of overuse. I follow my body instead, as it focuses on the demands of the trail. The last thing I want is a prepackaged interpretation of somebody else's experience. Taking a saint along on the trail, therefore, isn't an intellectual exercise. It's more like hiking with a Zen master, having someone to slap me upside the head as may be required. The words of the saint aren't meant to absorb me in thoughtful insight. More often than not, they stop thought altogether. Pay attention to what's going on around and within you, right now. That's what they invariably insist. So I seldom spend much time poring over a book in the wilderness. I graze, like bighorn sheep making their way over a rocky crag. I ponder lines I've underlined in a previous reading. I let the words sink in. Poetry is usually the best choice. A single saying of the desert fathers and mothers can be more than enough. Sometimes the experience of the trip may evoke an altogether different author from the one I've carried with me. Kicking myself for making a big mistake on the trail, I may have to go home to reread Luther on forgiveness. Witnessing an ecological disaster that cries out for justice, I return to dig out my worn-out copy of The Essential Gandhi. Saints have a way of coming to mind even when they haven't been brought along on the trail. The reality to which they point doesn't need a text to bring it to life. What makes this practice all the more necessary is that I'm a recovering scholar, a university professor overly dependent upon words, working his program. For too long, I've been addicted to footnotes, a compulsive attachment to critical analysis, an ugly habit of reading and writing to impress others. I've been trying for years, as an academic in recovery, to lure myself out of the university and into wilderness. I've been asking how the history of spirituality and a study of place, especially wild places, illumine the spiritual life. I long to hear the saints speak with a stark clarity 6 miles in from the trailhead. Their task is to call me up short. They leave me speechless before a mystery that's beyond my understanding, but not beyond my love. Become a lover, urged Hafiz, the 14th century Sufi mystic. As long as you see yourself as learned and intellectual, you'll lodge with the idiots. Moreover, if you can stop seeing yourself at all, you will be free. Candor is essential here. After 30 years of modest experience, I'm still a novice with respect to the skills of backpacking and wilderness wandering. I stand in amazement at Robert Cull's fortitude in spending a year alone on a deserted island off the coast of Patagonia. I am in awe of Doug Peacock's reckless forays into the grisly country of northern Montana. I marvel at Craig Child's rambling through the Utah desert for weeks at a time, disappearing from civilization as we know it. Compared to them, I'm just another Ed Abbey wannabe, like a lot of Western storytellers after a couple of beers in the local tavern. All I know is that solo backpacking is a practice that feeds me, even in moderately tame wilderness terrain. I don't have to face down grizzly bears or survive flash floods in desert slot canyons to feel fully alive in backcountry. Facing down myself is enough. Flash floods of imagined dangers are as scary for me as real ones. The interior landscape is the most dangerous territory I'm likely to explore. Yet to get there, I have to keep venturing further up and further in, as Aslan urged at the end of the Narnia Tales. The spiritual life, in my experience, is a matter of moving ever deeper into backcountry, both literally and figuratively. I'm fascinated by the discipline of body and mind that wilderness backpacking requires. Being pushed to your limits, you discover things about yourself and God that you wouldn't find in the safety and comfort of home. I'm not talking about a high-endurance, thrill-seeking embrace of risk. It's not macho prowess that attracts me to backpacking. I'm drawn by its attention to details. Packing light, going without, being alone, leaving no trace. My backpacking practice has no similarity to the extreme sports obsession of NCSM hikers in the High Sierras. These nothing-can-stop-me enthusiasts draw a straight line on a U.S. Geological Survey map and follow wherever it leads across miles of wild terrain, up rock faces, down talus slopes, across alpine lakes. I have no particular interest in extreme sports or extreme spirituality. I don't consider the pillar saints of 5th century Syria to be a model of spiritual formation, for example, despite their physical heroics and wilderness survival. They lived for years in solitude on a tiny platform 30 feet off the ground. My idea of going into wilderness isn't pushing the envelope in search of esoteric mystical experience. I might wish for that in my wildest dreams, but it never happens. Instead, I sit by an Ozark stream in the unpretentious company of sycamores and hawks. My body's relationship to the ordinary and earthbound is what I find most compelling. Like a lot of people, my experience of wilderness and spirituality is embarrassingly simple and unexceptional. In giving shape to this book, I've divided it into two sections. Part 1 includes the two introductory chapters that survey the overarching themes of the work, the appeal of wilderness in the spiritual life, and the dynamics of reading as it changes in a wilderness setting. The chapters in the second part of the book share my experiences on particular backpacking trips into the Missouri Ozarks and the Four Corners region of the American Southwest. They explore spiritual practices illuminated by the discipline of wilderness wandering. The listener who is ready to plunge straight away into backcountry experience without the baggage of analysis might skip the first part of the book, preferring to come back to it at the end. That's certainly the order in which it was lived, as well as the pattern of all meaningful encounters. The book draws on the insights of saints and mystics from various religious traditions. These include an early Celtic saint, 5 Catholics, 4 Protestants, a Buddhist, a Hindu, and a Sufi Muslim. In addition, references to the desert fathers and mothers in early Christianity are woven throughout the narratives, offering a unifying thread. The challenges that emerge in backcountry hiking are curiously akin to the monastic practice of those roughing it in the Egyptian desert of the 4th and 5th centuries. The desert Christians were firmly committed to a practice of silence and simplicity, to a reckless compassion, and a fierce indifference to unimportant things. What I'm calling the wilderness spirituality of these early desert adventurers involves the following convictions. 1. There are no easy routes to self-realization. It begins, ironically, with self-abandonment. 2. The spiritual life thrives on the margins of society, in a solitude framed by community. 3. Desire and relinquishment are a recurring pattern in wilderness experience. 4. Failure and making mistakes don't hinder spiritual growth. They occasion it. 5. The body, when disciplined, becomes an important teacher of spiritual insight. 6. Wilderness breeds a lifestyle of resistance, cultural critique, and cantankerous honesty. 7. A wider community of exchange becomes more apparent out in the wilds. For years, I've been trying to live my way into the truth these men and women taught. The most effective way I've found of doing so has been to shoulder a pack, setting out with a spiritual guide who's been that way before, following a slim trail into wilderness. Yet launching out into the boondocks isn't necessary for the practice of what I'm calling wilderness spirituality. You don't have to hike into backcountry or plunge into the desert to embrace a life lived on the edge. It means confronting whatever wilderness you happen to be facing in your life right now, whatever growth is imperative but also threatening in your experience. Sitting in the waiting room of radiation oncology, attending 12-step meetings, working the desk at a homeless shelter. All these force you into a wilder terrain than anything found at the end of a dirt road. They all involve risk. All require a discipline. Wilderness takes a different shape for everyone. What proves especially instructive to me in backpacking as a spiritual practice is how it surfaces the interior baggage I bring along on the trail. Entering the disarming silence of wilderness, neglected things rise to consciousness. Backpacking has as much to do with what I carry inside as with what goes into the pack. It connects me with woundedness as well as with wonder. Carl Jung says we repeat the significant traumas and ecstasies of our lives through dreams, rituals, and symbolic actions, continually renegotiating an interior landscape. Backpacking, in this sense, becomes a form of ritual activity, helping me explore unmapped trails of the psyche. Wilderness takes me back to the solace and thread I've found in other places in my life. The stars I recognize, the red sumac bringing the color of fire to autumn fields, the sound of falling water near a campsite. This is the same wilderness where trails quickly disappear, where lightning strikes closer to the tent than I'd like, where a copperhead lies coiled on the other side of the rock I've just climbed. It all leads to the deep mystery that I am healed, says Rilke, by the beauty that so coolly disdains to destroy me. The God I meet in wilderness is as fiercely loving as he or she is wild. Part 1. The Power of Wilderness and the Reading of Dangerous Texts. We are animal in our blood and in our skin, says Jay Griffiths, exulting in the wilderness from which we've all come and to which our souls are still bent. We were not born for pavements and escalators, but for thunder and mud. Out of the crucible of the desert wilderness in 4th century Egypt, a new form of spiritual life emerged among early Christian monks. Men and women, tested by its wild terrain and welcomed by its beauty, learned to read the mysteries of faith from its sandy pages. Others were attracted to these desert fathers and mothers, hungry for the power and simplicity they found in their lives. Over the centuries, a wide network of desert communities developed. Having fallen in love with a god of fierce compassion, these crusty desert dwellers shaped their lives after the pattern of the wild. The desert communities had very few books, but the ones they had, including the land itself, were held in high regard. The monks learned to read their scant texts not as consumers, extracting what is useful, informative, or entertaining, but as lovers, wanting to lick, smell, and savor the words on the page, lingering over it. They read the book in the way you might study a fascinating and dangerous landscape, as if it were writing itself into your psyche. 1. The Allure of the Wild. Backpacking as Spiritual Practice. I only went out for a walk and finally concluded to stay out till sundown, for going out, I found, was really going in. John Muir. The human body is not a closed or static object, but an open, unfinished entity, utterly entwined with the soils, waters, and winds that move through it. David Abram. For years, I've been making solo backpacking trips into the wilderness of the Missouri Ozarks. Leaving on a Friday afternoon, I'll invariably stuff a copy of one of the spiritual classics into my well-worn Kelty pack. I hike at times with John Reisbruck or Hildegard of Bingen, now and then with Rumi or Lao Tzu. Old mountains seem to invite the company of old teachers. Some of the oldest rock on the continent lies in the St. Francis Mountains of southeast Missouri. The creek beds are lined with Precambrian granite and pink rhyolite, rocks over 1.5 billion years old. In terrain like this, the earth itself is an ancient teacher, illuminating in unexpected ways the text I bring with me. These trips into backcountry are my way of occasionally retreating, like a hermit, into an isolated place, receiving spiritual direction from an old master. Without this regular discipline every few months, my life would move off center. Experience in backcountry feeds me like nothing else in my life. I'm fascinated by how the chosen site, the embrace of solitude, and the spiritual guide I happen to take along often have a way of coming together for me. I discover the holy in the smell of pine needles, the dread of gathering storm clouds, and the ache of shoulder muscles at the end of the day. The purpose of this book is to show how wilderness backpacking can be a form of spiritual practice, what Bill Plotkin calls a soulcraft exercise. Exposure to the harsh realities and fierce beauties of a world not aimed at my comfort has a way of cutting through the self-absorption of my life. The uncontrolled mystery of nature puts the ego in check and invites the soul back, in more than one way, to the ground of its being. It elicits the soul's deepest desire, enforces a rigorous discipline, and demands a life marked by activism and resistance. It reminds me, in short, that spiritual practice, far from being anything ethereal, is a highly tactile, embodied, and visceral affair. Aravaipa Canyon, entering the body of wilderness. Take Aravaipa Canyon, a stunning stretch of wilderness in southeastern Arizona, a place I've come to love. This is a remote land of red rockside canyons, white-haired cholla cactus, and Palo Verde trees that can't get enough of the color green. Studded with prickly pear and mesquite brush, the 12-mile-long canyon has been sacred to the Western Apache for centuries. It is a dazzling but wounded body of a place. Its deep ravines and tall saguaro cactuses possess a haunting beauty. This is a land that stalks people, the old teachers say. Its mystery is everywhere. Yet its vulnerability is apparent, too. On the way to the canyon, you pass miles and miles of mine tailings along the San Carlos mineral strip. Years of lead, zinc, and copper mining have left the land naked and wounded. A site traditionally known as Big Sycamore stands alone near the canyon's entrance, holds a still more painful memory. The Camp Grant Massacre of 1871 occurred here, leaving 125 Apache women, children, and elders slaughtered by local ranchers and vigilantes. Scars of hatred and misuse linger in the soil, despite the ravishing beauty of the place. It resonates with the loss of many things. Places like this are able to make momentary mystics of almost anyone. They evoke a powerful sense of presence, offering a point of entry into the deep interiority of things. G.K. Chesterton once observed that there are places that seem to happen and not merely to exist. Aravaipa Canyon is such a place. It doesn't stay fixed on any of the maps you draw. Going there is like walking into a dream you're just beginning to remember. A few years ago, at a turning point in my life, I spent a day and night alone in the desert above Brandenburg Wash near Aravaipa Canyon Ranch. I was transitioning toward retirement at the time, moving away from my role as a scholar, loosening myself from the bookish and theological world of the academy. I was being introduced to my body as a teacher instead. Walking alone into the desert that morning, carrying a gallon of water and a tarp, I hiked down a dry arroyo under the shadow of Flat Top Mountain near the canyon's western end. The colors and textures of rock were radiant in the morning sun. Suddenly, the arroyo I was following made a sharp turn, and the floor in front of me fell away, dropping 100 feet straight down. If I hadn't caught myself, I'd have walked right over the edge. I sat down by the rim to catch my breath, imagining flash floods in the past having rushed through this ravine, careening over the edge. My body began to enter the place in a way my mind hadn't yet been able to do. I sensed that I had been hiking all morning across the surface of the desert's body and had now been abruptly plunged inside it, seeing it from within. I'd been winding through swirling corridors of living rock in multiple shades of mauve, red, and pink, descending into the earth's breathing body. The memory of water, gouged into stone, was apparent everywhere. In purple-veined boulders, I imagined the internal organs of a great sleeping beast. Rocks eroding in convoluted folds looked like the gray matter of a living brain, neural pathways racing under the surface. Sitting by the drop-off, I felt as if I'd walked into the belly of a stunningly beautiful creature, hardly moving, but very much alive. It was a fleeting experience of what Buddhists call non-separation, seeing everything with a sudden familiarity and intimacy from the inside. I'd stumbled onto an exterior landscape that echoed my interior being. The painted rocks in the dry creek bed were the colors of my internal organs, heart, kidneys, lungs, torn ligaments, enlarged prostate. Pulsing red, dark blue, shining purple, vibrating with life, like an aching in the loins. The blowing wind was the susurrating sound of blood flowing. The side canyons were cavities within the earth's vital tissue, the innermost body of the Sonoran Desert. But I knew it also as my body. Hildegard of Bingen might have said that I'd touched the body of God as well, running my hand across a startling vulnerability. Blood-stained rocks and strip-mining scars lingered in its flesh, but the vibrating life was unmistakable. Here was a god known in the sinew and flesh of bedrock and cactus, smitten by longing, a great desert cat prowling the edges of abandonment, lurking unseen in the shadows, hungry for love. What made the experience even more vivid was the fact that a few weeks earlier, I'd been at the Whitney Western Art Museum in Cody, Wyoming. There I had stood in amazement in front of Thomas Moran's huge painting of the Grand Canyon of the Yellowstone. At the time, I hadn't known why the lower right-hand corner of the scene affected me so much, but I would recognize it later at Aravaipa Canyon. In the right foreground of Moran's painting, the artist moves beyond the signature grandeur of western rim rock and waterfalls to reveal a mass of exposed red rock. He lays open the earth's living body, allowing the viewer's intrusive eyes to gaze on its pulsating fragility. I stood there, staring at the bleeding form of a wounded animal, as if watching raw meat hanging in a butcher shop. I felt embarrassment at an intimacy violated, glimpsing something too personal to observe in another, as if I were gaping at a naked, strip-mined mountain in a desolate West Virginia landscape. I imagined the artist shouting through his work, "Look deeper than the frickin' scenery! All this is alive!" At the edge of the cliff at Aravaipa, I found myself inside Moran's painting, recognizing the earth's throbbing aliveness as deeply familiar. It was my body, too. Yet nothing in my culture or religious upbringing had prepared me for such an experience. I'd grown up accepting as perfectly normal the intellectual apartheid practiced by human beings in treating other forms of life as mere objects to be used. I hadn't read Jay Griffith's beautifully outrageous book, Wild, with her reprimand of Descartes' arrogance proclaiming humans the masters and possessors of nature. What we've gained in mastery, we've certainly lost in magic. John Burroughs, by contrast, took an exquisite joy in the Catskill Mountains as a sort of outlying part of himself. John Muir regarded the boulders of Yosemite in the same familiar way. He noticed on one of his forays into the wild that they seemed talkative and more lovable than ever. They are dear friends and have warm blood gushing through their granite flesh, and I love them with a love intensified by long and close companionship. This is the body's rich and feral knowing of the land. I experience it myself in those rare moments on the trail when I know that I belong, that the others there have been expecting me. I've come home in a deeply visceral way. I'm reminded again that loving is the truest way of knowing anything. A wilderness way of knowing, thinking with the body. One's body is the supreme teacher in backcountry hiking, plodding an uphill trail, mile after mile. It's the body that leads, not the mind. When I yield to its prompting, it carries me into a slow, steady pace I can maintain for hours. It releases endorphins, producing a profound sense of well-being, as well as increased levels of serotonin, a neurotransmitter that reduces stress. I bring along the 100-million-year history of my reptilian brain, moving like the highly refined animal that evolution has produced. I read the landscape with the distant memory of the African savannas. The oldest part of my brain is ready for fight or flight, pumping adrenaline into the bloodstream to protect me from saber-toothed tigers as may be necessary. The frontal lobes help me anticipate the consequences of choices I make along the trail. The physical movement of walking activates the subcortical region of the brain, including the limbic system, with its sensitivity to emotional states. Clearly, something far deeper and older than culture goes with me into wilderness. The body is an extremely reliable guide. It knows instinctively how to move over difficult terrain, when to stop for rest, how to breathe deeply and relax in crisis situations. Panic, by contrast, has its source in the mind, and the amygdala, to be precise. It forces me into action after I've failed to listen to the body's cues, its early warning system. The body is more naturally at home in wilderness, able to practice there the alive and alert presence in which it delights. Gary Snyder says wild terrain fosters a state of complete awareness. That's why we need it. It evokes an intuitive way of knowing, the way a newborn baby knows its mother's breast, the way a dancer anticipates her partner's practiced turn, the way a climber and the cliff he ascends share a reciprocity of touch. It is our most basic, animal-like, and impassioned way of knowing anything. What the mind hardly fathoms, the body already knows. Sometimes the body slides so completely into the rhythm of the trail that the mind follows its lead, relaxing comfortably into an effortless pattern of flow. Psychologists speak of this as a wondrous state of unforced, complete absorption in the activity at hand. It is what athletes speak of as being in the zone, acting on instinct and training without having to exercise deliberate thought. In a moment of flow, the ego falls away. Time flies. The body's fatigue is experienced as a high, opening the soul to an unexpected fluidity and immediacy of presence. This is something the mind can appreciate, but only the body knows. In wilderness hiking, one's body is the distinctive vehicle for experiencing mystery. It responds with inexplicable fear or delight to what the mind hardly recognizes. The power of shamanism in indigenous cultures around the world is rooted in this deep attunement of the body to the natural world. The shaman's gift doesn't depend on physical strength or prowess. She may even possess what others consider a physical disability, a unique sensitivity making access to the spirit world easier. The body is her fundamental connection to a deeper knowledge. The long-distance runners of the Tarahumara in Mexico, like the bushmen of the Kalahari in Botswana, have trained their bodies so well that they're able, over a period of days, to run down an antelope until it dies of exhaustion. Theirs is an intensely spiritual form of hunting that probes the depths of endurance for hunter and hunted alike. Religious experience, not infrequently, involves the body's being taken to its limits. In many folk traditions, yielding to bewilderment, the submission of body and mind to the ultimate challenges of wilderness, is a cultivated spiritual condition. The body, therefore, plays a major role in authentic soul work. Any radical separation of body and soul makes the spiritual life impossible, in fact. The Bible itself asserts the indissoluble relationship between the Adam, the human, and the Adama, the grounded earth. In the Jewish scriptures, the deepest realities of existence are always concrete, earth-related, and wild. One might best think of the soul, then, as the place where the body and the rest of the vibrant world converge. The German Romantic poet Novalis argued that the human soul isn't inside the body, hidden and encased like a seed. Rather, he said, "The seat of the soul is where the inner world and the outer world meet." Soulfulness is our ability to discover a vital connection with the ordinary details of everyday experience, what we share along our outermost edges with others. We are like trees, growing and touching at our periphery. The living core of a tree lies within an inch or so of its outer bark, where phloem and xylem tubes carry its lifeblood up and down the trunk. The rest of the interior is deadwood, a ringed history of growth and struggle. We, too, most readily encounter the other at our physical extremities. Like trees, our perimeters are where body and soul become most vulnerable and most connected to the rest of the world. Whenever I plunge into wilderness, my body and the environment move in and out of each other in an intimate pattern of exchange. I wade through water and inhale air filled with the scent of honeysuckle. I'm wrapped in cobwebs and pierced by briars. I swallow gnats drawn to the sweat on my body and feel the rocks on the trail through my boots. Where I end and everything else begins isn't always clear. What seems to be me doesn't stop at the fixed boundary of my skin. I come back with the sun having deeply penetrated this presumably impassable barrier. Rain and cold, not to mention poison ivy, chiggers, and ticks, move across this thin boundary of me with complete abandon. My skin isn't a rigid line of demarcation, but a permeable membrane that opens me to continual interchange with others. My personal identity is stretched to include the aching beauty of an alpine meadow or the raucous cry of loons on the other end of the lake. The addition of a saint seems to extend this encounter still further. The book of a wisdom elder becomes for me a silent yet tangible companion, assuming its own perilous adventure into wilderness. It moves, like me, into liminal space, risking rain and dirt, torn pages and loss. Reading in the wilds is a hazardous experience of reading with everything that is there. Far from being wholly cerebral, it connects my experience of the saint to the physical vulnerability of the text, the palpable reality of the surrounding terrain, and my own heightened sense of wilderness awareness, all of it riven with tactility and risk. Ecologist and poet David Abram speaks of an improvised duet that goes on between one's body and the fluid, breathing landscape it inhabits, molding one's experience of the text. The sounds of buzzing insects, the movement of squirrels and tree frogs, the breeze sweeping through the trees, all suggest the origins of language. Human speech initially arose out of our mimicry of nature. Thought patterns were influenced by our physical interaction with the terrain. Reading, therefore, especially in a wilderness setting, becomes a magical participation in the sounds and gestures of the natural world. It moves with the larger flow of an encircling landscape. The body is as important as the brain in this highly participatory process. That's why we need to think of the body in more fluid and communicative ways. For some people, says Barry Lopez, what they are is not finished at the skin, but continues with the reach of the senses out into the land. They find it difficult to maintain the illusion of the unmistakable difference between themselves and everything else. I remember reading Wendell Berry's poetry one summer morning, sitting at Togedy Pass, overlooking the expanse of the Grand Tetons to the west. The distinction between myself, the green paperback edition of his collected poems, and the adjacent Wyoming meadow filled with fireweed began to blur, in a singular moment of meeting. What I'd previously considered to be me had to be radically rethought. When Martin Buber observed that all real living is meeting, he was speaking of biological as well as spiritual truth. When John Muir spoke of going out as a way of going in, he knew that his deepest entry into himself and God came through the sensory immediacy of the High Sierras. He loved the mountains. He experienced them as an extension of his own body, an extension of God's exuberant grace. When he climbed Cathedral Peak in the summer of 1869, he realized how closely bound he was to everything there. He became a wonder to himself, a window onto the universe, a wilderness in his own right, pointing to mystery. Connecting with God in Wilderness. What I seek most in going into wilderness is not exercise or escape, but a physical and spiritual depth of intimacy. I'm moved by nature's power and beauty, but what sets me afire is the longing I sense there of everything else wanting to connect, the desire for an intimacy that is as alluring as it is frightening. I go to spend time alone with God, in a robust and full-bodied way. The two of us marvel at fresh deer tracks in the mud and black clouds looming over the ridge. We revel in the wildness and grieve over what isn't wild enough. We argue over the bloody business of insects devouring each other. We fall in love all over again. We connect. Abraham Heschel said we usually fail to understand the divine not because we aren't able to extend our concepts far enough, but because we don't know how to begin close enough. We think of the holy as up or out there, beyond the realm of campsites and chiggerbites. Yet God is an intimate reality found at the very heart of the universe and of ourselves. This, says Teilhard de Chardin, is the divine milieu. The highly sensory way of knowing that wilderness requires is the most natural and meaningful way I have of experiencing anything holy. My own earliest experiences of God go back to the lakes and swamps I haunted as a kid growing up in Central Florida. With other 10 to 12-year-olds, I made bamboo rafts, built huts of palmetto fronds, and caught crayfish and water snakes in makeshift nets. We were fascinated by the dark and overgrown places that other people avoided. Cypress swamps filled us with the wonder and terror of huge herons suddenly taking to flight, rotting things lying under the shallow water, dragonflies descended from a prehistoric world of dinosaurs. We came home, scratched and muddy, smelling something awful. But we loved it because of its edginess, its bizarre beauty. It's welcoming of things that didn't fit anywhere else. My awakening sense of mystery was heightened still further by the stories of Jesus I heard in the furnace room where the boys' Sunday school class met each week. It was the only space available to us, but it was perfect, hidden away, worldly and masculine, the one place in the church without any trappings of religion. We came to associate Jesus with wrenches on the workbench nearby, with the smell of fuel oil and a pilot light waiting to blow. I knew him to have Spanish moss in his hair and swamp muck between his toes. He was wild. He saw splendor in what others thought repulsive. And he loved, I was told, even me. These earthy images constitute my first experience of God. They fed a longing for what I couldn't put into words, but would always rediscover in wilderness places and hardware stores. Intimacy with God is an astonishing experience of distance traversed, as in the beginning of any relationship. The space between you and the other seems insuperable. You can't imagine yourself having the nerve to talk to a girl that fascinating, or a guy that full of life. You can't conceive of a forest that dark and threatening becoming a place by which you are loved. Yet it happens. What initially had put you off, because of admiration or fear, is overcome. You manage to arrange that first date, and it's amazing. You keep wandering into the forest, and you find it strangely healing. The greater the distance bridged, the greater your astonishment at the intimacy that results. What bothered me about church, however, was its notion of a distant, angry, masculine God who could only be approached through a gentle, meek, effeminate Jesus. This didn't match what I had experienced in the boys' class in the furnace room. I couldn't imagine loving or being loved by a God like that. Florida swampland, on the other hand, suggested images of a wild joy and welcoming presence that was comfortable with everything outside of the church. It fed a hunger in me for wholeness, for a love without bounds. I knew I was outgrowing my early church experience of God, even as I continued to memorize Bible verses and sit through revival meetings. My God was too big to be confined, too ravishing, too rough-edged, too passionate in seeking relationship. Only later would I learn, from the Christian mystics, that a love for God and for wilderness experience weren't incompatible at all. John of the Cross referred to God as a remarkably deep and vast wilderness, an immense, unbounded desert, the more delightful, savorous, and loving, the deeper, faster, and more solitary it is. Meister Eckhart spoke of the soul being thrown into the boundless hinterland of the divine, losing its identity there, yet discovering an utterly new life. For these mystics, being unhinged by the wild expanse of the Sierra Morena range in Spain or the towering firs of a Thuringian forest in Germany was an apt description of meeting the divine. All wildness is finer than tameness, John Muir proclaimed. In God's wildness lies the hope of the world. I found what I'd sought in Hildegard of Bingen's experience of the holy, as earthy as it was sublime. This 12th century German Benedictine received a vision of the universe as God's body. "I flame above the beauties of the fields," she heard God declare. "I shine in the waters, in the sun, the moon, and the stars I burn." She felt the airy wind thriving in all its green power and its blossoming, mountain waters flowing as if they were alive. She heard God thundering in it all. "I, the fiery power, lie hidden in these things, and they blaze from me." Hers was a God stretching a vast web of relationship, binding all things together as one. The greening power of the Spirit filled her with an exuberance that was contagious. Still another medieval mystic, Mechtild of Magdeburg, pictured this God of majesty, her true wilderness, as utterly smitten by love for souls like herself. Her God was undone in his aching desire to be reunited with everyone and everything from which he had been estranged. One night she imagined God saying to her, "Woman, I confess that I'm lovesick in my longing for you. I don't know if I can handle being God without you. I'm eternally wounded because of my love for your soul." Besotted by this wondrous confession, Mechtild responds to God in turn. "Let me find the salve that will heal your wound, dear love. I'll cut my heart in half and place you between the two pieces. I'll be your physician for all eternity." In her vision, God consents to her being the healer of his injured heart, longing to multiply their personal exchange in God's relationship with every other creature as well. Mechtild knew that the love wounds of the divine, scored in the earth itself, remained unhealed until the universe is knit together in love. In this medieval saint, I discovered the earthy, sensuous, and intensely personal relationship with God that I had longed for as a child. These mystics all insisted that knowing God is a matter of tasting, savoring, and relishing. It isn't an intellectual apprehension of something outside their experience, but a full-bodied encounter invoking images of desire, sensual delight, even sexual intimacy. God, in fact, is what gives vitality and meaning to the very notion of sensuality itself. Jonathan Edwards suggested that God is far more sensuous, more full of infinite delights, more prone to the endless expansion of relationships, more astonishingly beautiful than anything we can imagine in the stunningly sensuous world around us. In effect, he said, "If you think this world is sensual and beautiful, you haven't seen anything yet." I finally came to recognize a love for wilderness and a longing for God as a perfectly natural combination. Everything in creation is hungry for relationship. All bodies yearn for connectedness with each other and with the source of their energy and life. Indeed, one of the vital insights of the mystics and of the new cosmology is that everything is already linked by an underlying bond. Their prior connection is a given in the life of the universe. Ultimately, nothing is separate from anything else. The Hasidic master Yehuda Aryeh Leib argued that if there is no other God than the one true God, then all things must be joined in this one reality. We need to confess, then, that there is no being other than God. This is true even though it seems otherwise to most people. Everything that exists in the world, physical and spiritual, is God Himself. Because of this, every person can become attached to God wherever he is, through the holiness that exists in every single thing, even corporeal things. This is the foundation of all the mystical formulations in the world. This bold and adventurous language, bordering on pantheism, echoes a theme that stretches throughout the history of Jewish, Christian, and Muslim mysticisms. Nothing has being apart from its existence in God. The very foundations of the deep are grounded in Yahweh. God is that mystery in which we live and move and have our being. Allah, the merciful and compassionate, is closer to us than our jugular vein. What intrigues me in all of this is the crucial role the body plays in bridging the distance between ourselves and everything else. The body, this dazzling flesh we inhabit, is the necessary vehicle by which everything in creation connects. Our deepest spiritual relationships are inescapably material, substantial, and ecologically linked. The training of the body and the deepening of the soul are not, ultimately, separate realities. The monastic traditions have been reminding us of this for centuries. The Desert Fathers exulted in the physically demanding wilderness beyond the Nile. They saw it as an ideal locale for practicing the discipline of the body they considered essential to the spiritual life. For them, the body was a mentor of the soul. The physical challenges and harsh beauty of a desert landscape stripped them of non-essentials, drew them into silence, and assured them that they could be loved in the most uncaring of places. The body taught them this as it took them to the edge of themselves, the desert, and God. John Climacus at Mount Sinai found it astonishing that the spiritual can be purified and refined by clay. "What is this mystery in me?" he asked, marveling at his body's ability to touch the heights as well as the depths of human experience. When the body is brought under discipline, it becomes a grand teacher in its sensitivities and in its frailties. Nowhere do we discover this better than in the wild places where our limits become most apparent. I want to end this chapter by juxtaposing two parallel experiences of the wild. One is deeply religious and mystical, the other much more earthy and prophetic. Yet both are profoundly sensuous in the way they savor a uniquely transformative experience. The first is from William of St. Thierry, a 12th century French monk riding from his abbey in the heavily forested, vine-growing region of Champagne. The other is from Chelles Glendinning, a 20th century eco-psychologist living in the high desert country of northern New Mexico. They each struggle to convey an experience for which they lack adequate language. William of St. Thierry sits in prayer, gazing out the cloister window onto the vineyards growing in the shadow of the Ardennes. I imagine a glass of wine on the table nearby as he muses, "Sometimes, Lord, while I am gaping toward you, eyes closed, you place something in me, in the mouth of the heart. I certainly sense a flavor so soft, so sweet, so comforting, that if it were left perfect in me, I would no longer go searching for anything else. But when I receive it, you do not let me figure out what it is. Yet I hope to transfuse it through all the veins and marrow of my soul like some life-giving sap, so as to lose the flavor of all other affections and no longer savor anything except it alone, you alone." Chelles Glendinning speaks in turn of the astonishment she encounters on a magical New Mexican evening. "I had been eating a simple dinner of brown rice and greens on the roof when I felt something occur in my body, something like a door swinging open, wide open. A golden sun was just setting behind the Hamas Mountains. Bursts of orange and pink were shooting like streamers through the fading sky. To my surprise, I was sensing the full-bodied aliveness of every juniper and rock and hawk on the earth. By the front door to my house, I saw, really saw, the tall pinyon that I ordinarily brushed by. Its needles and cones were bursting with presence, its branches and trunk with consciousness. I had never before communicated directly with it, nor with any other wild being. I saw how foolish I had been. My recovery from Western civilization was underway." Both of these experiences involve a deep sense of immediacy, an avid yearning for relationship, a quality of presence far more than the mind can grasp. Though written in very different idioms, they speak of analogous things. My goal in this book is to foster a conversation between those, like William, who hunger for a sensual spirituality, and those, like Chelles, who are fed by an earthy experience of the natural world. Hopefully, those who can identify with only one of the two, finding the other suspicious, might begin to discern new ways of naming what they've already experienced. But we need beginner's mind in doing this, a widening of our previous grasp of what is, a reorientation of language. When we are stunned to the place beyond words, we're finally starting to get somewhere, says Anne Lamott. I marvel at how wilderness cuts through my tired interpretations of reality, my expectations of what the universe ought to be like. In its hush of all that stirs within me, I discover new ways of articulating the world. I learn with Jack Kerouac that silence itself is the sound of diamonds cutting through anything. He wrote this in 1956, during his 63 days as a fire lookout on Desolation Peak in the North Cascades. There his soul reveled in what his body needed most, the stillness and stark simplicity of wilderness. Getting to where we need to go often means finding a new language for where we've already been. 2. The risk-taking character of wilderness reading. Books, not the ones which afford us a cowering enjoyment, but in which each thought is of unusual daring, such as an idle man cannot read and a timid one would not be entertained by, which even makes us dangerous to existing institutions. Such call I good books. Henry David Thoreau. Books are made with razor-sharp paper that can easily cut you. Dangers of Reading Books. YourGuideToLive.com, the Internet. Spiritual reading can be dangerous. I'm not talking about the devotional pabulum you find in most religious bookstores, but the truly risky stuff, from Hafiz and Eckhart to Toni Morrison and Oscar Romero. This is especially true of the spiritual classics, says theologian David Tracy. They confront us with the disturbing notion that something else might be the case. They haunt us with fundamental questions, overthrowing our previous ways of viewing the world. Reading a potentially dangerous book in a landscape perceived to be dangerous can be doubly hazardous. The place heightens the vulnerability occasioned by the text. Challenging books lose their bite when they're read comfortably at home in a favorite armchair. Their riskiness increases, however, when read by firelight in a forest glade 10 miles from the nearest road. The place where you encounter a book indelibly affects the way you receive it. Klaus Westermann read the Psalms in a Russian prison camp, discovering patterns that changed his life as well as his approach to biblical scholarship. Eldridge Cleaver read Thomas Merton in Folsom Prison. Alexander Solzhenitsyn read Dostoevsky in a Soviet cancer ward. Karl Marx read The History of Capitalism in the Elegance of the British Museum. Potentially revolutionary changes occur when people read explosive texts in unsettling places. The stories of the saints are filled with instances of this. Isaac of Nineveh's world was turned upside down as he read the scriptures in the desert solitude of the Zagros Mountains in 6th century Persia. He allegedly made himself blind through his constant pondering of the tear-stained pages. Near the end of his life, Francis of Assisi read the story of Christ's passion, not simply from the pages of the Gospels, but from the huge, split rocks atop Mount Laverna. He said these cracks had appeared on Good Friday when the stones on Calvary were also rent. He experienced their truth in the opening of wounds in his body through the gift of the stigmata. The mountainous terrain and his body's interaction with it became active participants in his reading of the text. The saints often gave themselves to outdoor, especially wilderness, readings at periods of transition in their lives. Saint Jerome read his Greek New Testament outside a cave in the Syrian desert before beginning his work on the Vulgate. Prior to being made Bishop of Lindisfarne, St. Cuthbert read the Psalms each morning, standing waist-deep in the surf on Northumberland's rocky coast. Hildegard of Bingen started recording her visions at the age of 42 as she and her sisters, fresh from their work in the vineyards, read the Holy Office with dirt under their fingernails. St. Bernard delighted in the Valley of Aube outside his monastery at Clairvaux as he began preaching his 86 sermons on the Song of Songs. St. Seraphim studied the Philokalia each day in the dense forest of 19th century Russia before undertaking his midlife ministry to pilgrims. Encountering texts, even familiar ones, in out-of-the-way places at moments of significant change has an unnerving way of prompting new insight. The book assumes a fresh life in the offbeat, unpredictable place. When I ponder the writings of a given saint in a wilderness setting, multiple things are going on at the same time. One, there's the reading of the surrounding landscape, demanding my careful attention in hiking it alone. Two, there's the reading of the unexplored interior wilderness that I bring along with me, mirrored by all that is wild beyond the trail. Three, there's the life and thought of the saint I carry, formed out of the ascesis, or spiritual discipline, of his own venture into wilderness. Four, there's the book itself that I've sealed in a Ziploc bag, carrying a stubborn life of its own. Five, and finally, there's the reading of God's wild splendor in between the lines of all these other texts. What is born in these sundry readings is a deeper apprehension of the truth I encounter. My sense of vulnerability and compassion are expanded as I share in a wider community of receptiveness. The best way I can exemplify the process is to provide several examples of my own wilderness encounters with particular texts. I've included three vignettes in this chapter, offering a taste of how backpacking serves as a spiritual practice. They draw on the pattern of wilderness spirituality seen in the desert fathers and mothers. The narratives are all taken from a single year of Ozark hiking in places along the eastern edge of the Missouri Ozark bioregion. This is a rugged and beautiful landscape known for its spring-fed streams and karst geology, a text never exhausted by a single reading. Vignette 1. Bell Mountain, John Bunyan on Simplicity. It is late October, and I'm bushwhacking my way down a ridge in the Bell Mountain Wilderness area toward a ribbon of water sheltered by yellow and orange maple trees in the hollow below. I'll camp there beside Shut-In Creek tonight, falling asleep to the sound of running water. I may wake to the cries of coyotes in the night, but I'll recognize familiar stars and go back to sleep with the contentment that only wilderness affords. Half of the beauty in coming here is the simplicity it demands. Backpacking reminds me of how little I require to be happy, how light I can travel, how many of the resources I imagine I need are superfluous out in the wild. We need great vigilance in all things, says John Climacus, the 6th century abbot of St. Catherine's Monastery at Mount Sinai, but especially in regard to what we have left behind. He spoke of haplotis, the deliberate abandonment of unimportant things, as a spiritual practice that wilderness teaches supremely well. I'll eat simply tonight, bread on a stick baked over an open fire, washed down with creek water, and the guilty pleasure of a little Jameson's Irish whiskey. I'm reduced here to a life that John Climacus described as simple and uncompounded. I've brought along on the trip a copy of John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress, an apt choice for reflecting on simplicity and non-attachment. In Bunyan's allegory of the Christian life, his pilgrim undertakes a long trek through the wilderness of this world to the celestial city. He passes through the Slough of Despond, where he nearly drowns. He loses the trail in opting for an easier way through Bypass Meadow. He trudges up the hill of difficulty and through the valley of humiliation. Disoriented again and again, he rediscovers the path in sighting the distant wooded slopes of the Delectable Mountains. I think of his difficulties as I remember how many times I myself have been tricked in hiking through this winding hollow at the foot of Bell Mountain. The similar-looking ravines leading into it twist in different directions. I've often been convinced I was on the right one, only to find myself an hour later, several miles from where I'd expected to be. You have to trust the compass in hiking such terrain. The most obvious path is often the wrong one. Hiking the Ozark wilderness is never quite what one expects. It requires your leaving behind all your preconceptions, the baggage that keeps you from being fully present. Bunyan speaks of Christian starting his journey with a heavy burden. This isn't a backpack with the basics needed to sustain him on the trail. It's a heavier, inner burden that falls from his shoulders only as he passes overhanging cliffs, ascending a hill to the place of the cross. Hikers invariably carry two packs on traveling into wilderness. I can adjust the straps of the one easily enough, but releasing the other is beyond my skill. It holds the things I...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.